Assalamualaikum and good morning everyone. Today we will look into lecture number 7. In lecture number 7, which is the deconvolution part, I will separate into 4 parts. The first one, 7A, the introduction to deconvolution. 7B will be in Wiener filter or inverse filter. The third one, 7C, is a Wiener filter for spiking deconvolution. And 7D, Wiener filter for predictive deconvolution. So for today, I will give you some briefing on the deconvolution part. So in the 7A, basically at the end of this lesson, you should be able to define the purpose of deconvolution in seismic data processing, differentiate between different types of deconvolution, and implement the deconvolution techniques in real seismic data. And this particular deconvolution part is related to course learning outcome number 1, which is the recognize the basic data processing sequence, as well as CLO number 3, to process a real seismic reflection data. And this map to the following PO number 1 and PO number 2. Okay, where does the deconvolution come in? It's basically after we finish all the noise attenuation, we complete the FK and frequency filtering, we already conduct our geometry analysis, then before you do data sorting, we conduct the deconvolution process. Okay. In real seismic data processing, basically the deconvolution part came within the Taupi. Okay, it's not separate like what I shown here. Okay. Okay, for example, in the when we process a real seismic data, the deconvolution most of the time will be combined with the Taupi method, which is along with the multiple attenuation. They call it Taupi deconvolution. Alright. However, for the purpose of understanding the concept, first you need to look into the deconvolution as a separate entity. Alright. Okay, so actually what is deconvolution? Deconvolution is a process to compress the seismic wavelet in a recorded seismogram. Okay, as we know, the wavelet travel from the source, go into the subsurface, convolve with the earth reflectivity, and then you record the upgoing wavelet at the receiver. Deconvolution also able to reconstruct the reflectivity function. Okay, as we know, after the seismic acquisition, the seismic trace that we got contain the reflectivity function. We want to recover back, we want to reconstruct back by eliminating the effect of the wavelet. Okay, by eliminating the wavelet or compress the wavelet, in the meantime, you will also improve the temporal resolution. You should able to shorten the signal as well as suppress the noise. In the meantime, if you at the end of this deconvolution method, which is in lecture 7D, you will see that deconvolution also able to attenuate the multiples and reverberations. Okay, it applied before stack, but can also apply to a stack data. It should be no problem, and it's not exclusively in either domains. Okay, it can be in short domains, it can be in CDP domains, it can be in receiver domains, doesn't matter. Okay, you may try in different domains to find out which domain is suitable for your particular data. Yeah, to understand the deconvolution, we need to understand the elements of the recorded seismic trace. Okay, you need to build the block of the seismic trace, the convolution model, by constructing a synthetic seismogram. Before we go into detail, you need to know some general assumptions involving the deconvolution process. The first assumption is that the Earth is made up of horizontal layers of consistent velocity. Okay, in other words, it's a heterogeneous media. It's not inhomogeneous, it's not homogeneous, but heterogeneous. In other words, you have a certain layers of consistent velocity horizontally. To aid your understanding, let me draw. Okay, horizontal layers of consistent velocity indicate like this. We have a surface like this, and then this is your first layer. This is your second layer. This is your third layer. In other words, the velocity from the left to the right contain a same velocity. And then in the second layer, from the left to the right contain a same velocity. Okay? In other words, you don't have any anomaly in between. Okay? When you have something like this, it's called inhomogeneous, where your velocity literally changing from the left to the right hand side. Second assumption is that the source generates a compositional plane wave, in other words, only P wave. Thus, no shear wave is generated. We only consider a PP, not PS. Okay, PP indicate P downward and P reflected, upward. Okay, only consider this kind of wave. We will not consider the shear wave that was generated from the reflection. This one we will not consider. Okay. The third assumption is that the source waveform does not change as it travels in the subsurface. Okay. We have an assumption that it contains a uniform waveform, the uniform wavelet as it travels in the subsurface. The seismic trace is basically represent the Earth reflectivity series. This is the signal that you recorded at the receiver. And the seismic trace is basically the convolution of the reflectivity series with the wavelet. You fire up the source, the wavelet that from the source travel into the subsurface, convolve with all the reflectivity function before it going upward and recorded at the receiver. Okay? In other words, your seismic trace given by ST is actually a convolution between the Earth reflectivity RC with the wavelet. Okay. Once you do the convolution, you came out with the seismic trace. Okay. It's a forward modeling process. A seismogram which is constructed from sonic and density log. Basically, this is the one that you do in your EMP. The one that we consider in the deconvolution process is in this part, where your synthetic seismogram, okay, your seismogram, or in other words, your seismic trace, is specifically is equal to your reflection coefficient times with the wavelet. Okay, once you do the convolution in the time domain, or you do the multiplication in frequency domain. Okay. How to convert from depth to time? Okay, basically you need a select sampling interval. If possible, look at the seismic station and use the velocity information from the log to convert the depth axis to the two-way time vertical time axis. This basically is what you want to apply during your EMP project. You need, when you want to convert from depth to time, please make sure that you convert based on the log data, not based on the seismic data. The convolutional model. Okay, before we go into the deconvolution, first we look into the convolution. As we learn in the lecture number 3, in the signal analysis, convolution is basically a combination of two signals. You have the input function and you have a filter function or another function. Okay, the convolution will give you the output function. In the deconvolution in the forward modeling, in the accreditation process, the input function is your wavelet, while your filter function is your reflectivity, the Earth reflectivity, the Earth response. Okay. The convolution between these two, okay, in the time domain, will give you the seismic trace that you record at the receiver. This is in terms of the time domain. When you want to implement the convolution, basically this is the function that we use during the convolution. The summation of the G, F, the summation of the G times with the F is equal to Y. Okay, where G is the input function, the wavelet, F is the filter function or reflectivity, and Y is your output, the seismic trace that you got at the receiver. This is another example. Okay, as we learned in previous lecture, when you want to convolve between FK and GK, as I taught you before, you need to flip and slide. When you slide, you need to multiply and add. Okay, you need to do a lot more practice if you are not really familiar how to do the convolution. Please see my tutorial and please try to complete the convolution practice. Okay, the impulse response that you got is in this is the earth reflectivity, while the software flag is from the source. When you convert between these two, this is the seismogram the seismic trace that you got at the receiver. As you notice, it mentioned over here is noise free. In other words, this is the ideal one. Okay, in reality, your seismogram over here contained with a lot of noise. Okay. First, we look into the convolution model. Consider an earth model that consists of homogeneous horizontal layers. Okay, this is the homogeneous or heterogeneous horizontal layers. Where you have the velocity constant from the left to the right hand side without any anomaly in the between. Acoustic impedance is given by density times with the velocity. The reflection coefficient associated with the interface is given by this formula. Zi is equal to Iz plus I plus 1 minus Iz divided by Iz plus 1 plus Iz. Okay, the amplitude reflection coefficient. Assuming the change of density with that is negligible, okay. In other words, the velocity, the density is more or less change doesn't much, it's negligible. Therefore, the z is equal to vz plus 1 minus vz divided by vz plus 1 plus vz, okay. From reflection coefficient, we can compute the impulse response of a horizontally layered earth. Okay, basically, your acoustic impedance is totally depends on the velocity, not on density. Unfortunately, impulse response contains not only primary reflection, but also others such as multiple and noise. Okay, we will look into the multiples in the lecture number 8, while in terms of noise, we already eliminate in FK filtering and frequency filtering. In forward modeling or seismic acquisition, your output XT, the seismic trace here, is given by wavelet times convolve with the earth reflectivity plus some noise. Okay. As we know, the output that this XT we know do from the our seismic trace. The wavelet signature, WT, is unknown or partially known, we not really know. While the earth reflectivity, we can estimate from the log. Noise, totally, we don't know. Okay, we just eliminate the noise previously. We have, in this case, we have one equation, two unknown and one known. The only known is the XT. In order to solve the equation, we need to make a few assumptions. Okay, the convolutional model. The first assumption is that the source waveform is known. Okay? In other words, the WT is known. And the second assumption is that it's a noise-free seismogram. In other words, we need to eliminate the noise first. Okay? Once we eliminate the noise, means that we only have one unknown. Okay? WT. And ET is known already from the well log. And we know the XT. Therefore, we can solve for the equation. Basically, we have two types of deconvolution. For a known source waveform, the solution is deterministic. For unknown source waveform, the solution is statistical. Deterministic solution requires spiking deconvolution because the desired output is a spike. While for statistical solution, okay, for the unknown source waveform, we need to predict. Therefore, it's called predictive deconvolution. Okay, for unknown source waveform, you need to use statistic. Okay, therefore it requires prediction. Therefore, we call it predictive deconvolution. For a known source waveform, for the known input, as I mentioned in the previous slide, it's a deterministic. It just determine, and that's why it's called a spiking deconvolution. Okay, because the output is a spike.